Hey, this is Tim Strange, and you're listening to SWN.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And I've got another returning guest back to talk about a hot topic in professional wrestling going on right now. He was originally number 19 on my episode list from October 2020, which feels like a lifetime away. He's back for episode 192, which is almost poetic. It's the merchandise.
Wow.
Mike Musso.
How are you doing, Billy?
I'm doing very well. Like I was saying off the recording, I'm now just passing back and forth a cold with my seven-month-old, so I'm having a great time.
Wait till he goes to school or nursery, and then you don't just have to worry about him catching a cold from the environment you're in. You have to worry about 29 other kids that he shares a class with passing their colds on. It's just going to get worse, Billy. I'll just have to give you the heads up.
I'll get a watch some Raw Rumbles. He'll throw those 29 over the top rope, and I'll never have to deal with a cold again. That's my thinking there.
That's really funny, actually, during COVID. They were putting all these protections in place and stuff, and the most dangerous thing was opening the schools back up. Not that I was against it, you know, the kids needed to go back to school, but that was, you're not allowed to go shopping, like with more than two of you. You were supposed to be alone in the supermarket. You can send your child to school to sit in a classroom with 30 other kids that have come from 30 other households, and it was just one of the many things that didn't make sense and left me scratching my head. Never mind, we're here to talk about wrestling, not the complexities of COVID regulations, which are thankfully now in the rearview mirror.
Exactly. We don't want to talk about politics here on a wrestling podcast. That would be an absolute, that would be terrible. Those two things should never meet. So like I said, it's been October 2020 since we last kind of spoke in this kind of environment. How's it going?
Good. I'm feeling much healthier than I was the last time we spoke. Trying to think what I would have been going through at that time. Obviously had the back injury, and then found out that I couldn't breathe properly anymore. I wrestled a few times last year, but a few months ago I was put on new medication. I don't know why I wasn't put on this medication initially, or why they left me for so long without reviewing it. The new medications actually work wonders. I was kind of settling, or I was like, God, this is going to be as good as it gets. And I was kidding myself on that it was an improvement. It was an improvement, but nothing significant. But with this new medication I'm on, I'm not going to say I'm feeling like my cardio is at the level it was before, but I've seen an amazing improvement. So I'm on a bit of a high at the moment. I mean, realised that medications allowing me to live life the way I did before all these allergies and asthmas and all these different things that I was diagnosed with came into play.
That's it. It's often a cocktail of things they have to try and mix and get right before they actually find the right thing. I mean, this is absolutely not wrestling related. My throat problems for years, and it put me through things like I'd have tonsillitis a certain number of times before they'd actually refer me any further. But I went through tests for HIV because I thought, well, could be that somehow. Went through all these tests and eventually just went, I'll whip your tonsils out. And that was it. I was mixed.
Sorted.
So it's just that.
I know my body and I knew something was wrong. I mean, that at first they thought I'd had a heart attack in the ring in Forfar, which was the scary point where nobody knew what was going on. They ruled out the heart attack after all these blood tests. Blood pressure was ridiculous, heart rate was ridiculous, and they were trying to, the specialist was trying to insist that I had a anxiety attack. I've seen anxiety attacks. I probably have suffered from anxiety at times, and I knew it wasn't that, so he put me on the list for further investigation. And when they did all the tests, they found out that my breathing capacity had reduced by 60%, which is substantial. Some doctors are great, but don't put all your trust in them because they get it wrong a lot. I knew something wasn't right. I would have, if I listened to that doctor, I would have turned off and thought I had anxiety and never got to the bottom of any of these issues. It was a real I wasn't getting enough oxygen in my body. The breathing tube had narrowed that much. 60% is bad.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. I think remember we did speak about that last time. We were like, it was scary to consider. So we've got this. I think we should just go into the hot topic. I think that because we might speak about it for a while, might only be 10 minutes, but I think you've got a lot of opinions to get out there to the world, and we'll provide the platform to do that. So really, it's about the influx of new promotions in Scotland or general in the world. Except we're not going to name them, but there has been quite a few companies. I think by my records, right, I've got 29 active promotions in Scotland at the moment. Well, some don't have shows yet, but 29 promotions. We cover 18 of them, plus things like Copenhagen and Grado's Family Bash and stuff like that, which is a hell of a lot. So what was the topic you wanted to discuss? And we'll get into it.
It is a hell of a lot. It's not just all these new promotions. Everybody's got an opinion on that. And that's really, I think, something that I want to talk about is how everybody has an opinion on it. And nobody really has a fix for it, or a workable fix. I'll say right now, I don't either. But I don't feel anybody's really drilled down and analysed why we're in this situation, how this has happened, and what responsibility we, as the people that have ran wrestling in this country and our equivalent in every other country. I don't know how bad it is in the States. I don't think Europe is as advanced as we are in terms of the age of the lineage of a promotion and then an offshoot of that promotion and an offshoot of that promotion. I don't think they're as far down the road as we are, but that's not to say that that's not going to be where they end up. But I just feel that everybody has an opinion, and the opinion is usually self-serving, which is human nature. Be self-serving with your opinion on something like this. This affects my business, so I'm going to look at it through my tunneled lens and say, this is bad, they shouldn't be doing this. Well, the problem is, why are they doing it? Why are these new promotions popping up? How was this facilitated? And what right do, what part did we play in facilitating it? Given we facilitated it, what right do we have to then say, no, you're not allowed in this business? The bottom line is, none of us have a right to say somebody isn't allowed to be a wrestler or to run a wrestling event. The answers to that would be some sort of regulation. Who's going to agree to regulation? We're not a sport. We are, to use the Vince term, we're sports entertainment. We sit on our own. If we were a sport, there would be so much regulation. If you think about it, I mean, Billy, what do you think the average crowd is in Scotland?
You probably look at about 150 would be your average, or 200, unless you get your bigger shows. But I'd say 200 would be your cap off for most promotions.
100 would be like, it's a good crowd. 150 would be its average.
Yeah.
I think, yeah. So doing the maths on that, average ticket price.
Right. Let's say 10. Yeah.
So that's £1,500 in ticket sales. That's not big business. How much do you think a venue costs?
I'm just looking at things for birthday parties at the moment, and way more than you'd think.
I mean, a few hundred. Say three. You could be generous, two. Small little community hall, maybe 150. This charges their posters. How much are they going to cost? Depends how many you put out. That's another 100 at least on your bill. Before you know it, your hall and your posters, you've gone through £500. And that doesn't include your insurance cost, your public liability insurance per show, depending on how many shows you run and dilute cost. Maybe 100. If you run lots of events, 75, 50 maybe at most. you can see how quite quickly this budget been not. How much room after you've then, and then you've got talent budget and their associated expenses, any ring maintenance, any technical. The point I'm getting to here, and I remember years ago I brought this up, like I called it superstar syndrome, where everybody was acting like this was maybe 2010, something like that, and everybody was acting like the business was on fire and we were doing this amazing business. And I was like, everybody's knocking about like superstars, thinking they're main event in Madison Square Garden, when really they're a star amongst the locker room and they're the trainees from that promotion. Other than that, they're not being recognized when they go down the street, and you know they're not demanding like a limousine to take them to the event because they've got that much drawing power. Not at all. And some of the reaction when I put that out there was, why are you belittling all the hard work that we've done? And I was maybe quite harsh in the way I worded it back then. So I want to say right now that I am not trying to belittle anybody's efforts, anybody's work. Our attendances, you can count them. I'm not going to lie about it. A lot of people lie about attendances and they're like, oh, we got 300 in tonight when it was really 200. So yeah, as a wrestler, if I think the crowd's jumped up 100 pounds, I've got my hand out. I'm like, well, we've done really well. We're getting a bonus from that. You know, so I don't see the point. It's like you lie about the attendance, but then when it comes to pay, you're like, oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, we do 150, 200. I'm not going to slag myself off. We work really hard for that 150 average. And when it gets up to 200, that's all good. We've got 200 in tonight. When we do the other events and we get 50, 300, 350, that's amazing. But in the context of things, when you're super happy at a crowd of three, I think the biggest crowd we've done maybe is 385 in the past 10 years or something like that. Just under 400. That's not that impressive. It's amazing by the average standards. It's not that impressive. So all I'm saying is I think amongst the wrestling scene at the moment, there's a wealth of talent, really good talent. Everybody's putting so much work in. The actual product, amazing. I just think we should be more grounded and understand how much, where our business is at. I am fascinated by speaking to people that were around in the sort of glory days of British wrestling. And there's a William Regal podcast that somebody drew my attention to where he talks about this. He heard about how the scene was on fire in Britain and it was amazing and all this stuff was going on. And he pointed out on this podcast he did, it was a load of smoke and mirrors. He said that there was a great talent, some really good events going on. The top promotions were running once a month, twice a month. That's not a business that's on fire. If you look when we were on ITV, I had very little to do with it in the 80s. I was a child. I had nothing to do with it. But if you look at when British wrestling was on ITV, those guys were on the road for like they were doing Monday night shows, Tuesday night shows, Wednesday night shows, twice on Sunday. It was sold out buildings, 500 to 1,000 people in the best halls in the country. And they were making a full-time living, not just the promoter and one or two guys that were doing a training school on the back of it. The whole team was touring the country, making a full-time living off professional wrestling. We're not there now. We're a long way from there. So the idea of regulation on top of the fact of considering how small our business is at the moment, fantastic products up and down the country, well done everybody. I'm just saying we should all be more mindful of how big the business is. Do you get where I'm coming from, Billy? Like this delusion of grandeur isn't doing anybody any favours.
I mean, wrestling's a niche. It's a niche anyway, and Scottish wrestling in itself is a niche of a niche. And I mean, doing a podcast about it, it's just adding an extra layer of niche to it. So as long as, I don't know whether there's more case of folk are trying to get a sliver of this pie that's going on. I don't know whether it's more a case of there's promotions coming in that are maybe going into areas where, I don't know, maybe it's considered a lack of respect. Like, they're going into areas where other promotions are regularly running there, or I don't know where to begin with this topic, to be honest. As someone who's on the other side of the fence here, that's watched enough of it to maybe have a little bit more information than most. I wouldn't even know where to begin going into this. But
you mentioned respect there. I mean, that does come into it, but that's when you're talking about, I say, are we talking about business or are we talking about business brother? I mean, right. Like, we in a wrestling bubble here talking about business, or are we talking about actual business, a profit and loss column, doing business with people that are with the wrestling bubble, talking to advertisers, sponsors, blah, 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 blah. Not some weird wrestling rules that exist only in our little bubble. Because there's a lot of them. It's because we date back to the carnivals. We have that sort of mentality. And that's how wrestling was designed to be. Wrestling was a work. I'm sorry if I'm busting your bubble here, Billy.
Can't believe it. 192 episodes and wrestling's not real.
But, you know, that's where our business came from. It was designed to make people think that conflict was real and allow people to be entertained by this fictitious conflict. And people would, you know, on the outcomes, or you'd make a wrestler look beatable, and then you'd challenge the village tough guy to come in. He'd fancy his chances, and he'd annihilate somebody that was a trained fighter, as opposed to as well as being a worked wrestler from the matches that had allowed that village hard man to think he could take him down. So that's the roots of our business. And I'm not saying we should go back to that. Like, people use carny a lot in a really bad way, but a lot of the, like, almost like a disparaging remark. I love it when somebody calls me a carny, or that's Mike Carney again. I think a lot of the carny ways of thinking protected the business yet, obviously. Also, it protected the longevity of business, because nothing was done that would jeopardize making money next week. You wouldn't sacrifice next week to get a one-off day. And by pop, I mean financial. And we've totally lost that now. Like, nobody thinks like that anymore. It's all about, it's all, from very talented people, it's all, like, let's make the biggest noise we can, A, to get attention, to get hits on the internet. And this brings me to, how did this happen? 20 years ago, and I've told this story to a lot of people in wrestling, it's been a subject that's come up more and more in recent years. I mean, I'm still the right side of 40, by the way, but I'm getting a bit older and wiser. 20 odd years ago, I was in a van with somebody that was hiring a ring and somebody that was running a show. And that person was, I'm not going to name the wrestler that ring was being used, but I was in the ring with David Harris, who you might recognize that name from W3L yesteryear event. Me and David Harris had both trained with Jake Roberts in St. Albans, Aldershot, and this was maybe 2006. And this wrestler, we're sitting in the van, he goes, David Harris is promoting his first show. So he was about the same age as me, like 18, 19 maybe. And this wrestler in the van said, "This is brilliant. You know, few years we make all our money from the trainees now. You all want to learn to wrestle, so you pay us to teach you, and you all want to hire the ring and run your own shows. It's brilliant." Now, if you think about that in the early 2000s, we were, again, we had nothing to do with being on ITV World of Sport, but British wrestling was that point, about 15 years removed from being on television, the tribute novelty of Mincy, UK Undertaker and the Mankind and all that kind of stuff, those were brilliant, by the way. The houses, that's where I learned, that was my first stop. Those shows were jam-packed. They put our attendances today to shame. I'd get like 10 dates. This is where we're going to be, Mike, if you want to come along, help set up. And I got my first few matches on those shows. And 500-600 people in these leisure centres, jam-packed. But that was the novelty of that was starting to wear off. It was becoming more, the WWE was coming more frequently, so it was less of a novelty to see somebody dressed up as Kane when you could go to your local, like, Glasgow Arena and see the real Kane, you know. So this was really attractive to those guys. All of a sudden, making money from selling tickets was being replaced by monetizing entry into the wrestling business. So not entry into a show via a ticket, monetizing entry into the wrestling business. If you pay me, I'll let you in. 20 years previous, if you were brand new, it's not my story to tell, so I'm not going to name names, but somebody told me a sort of very well-respected British wrestling name, told me a story about when they started out, they were in the dressing room and one of the old-timers was like staring at them. Eventually he said, you're trying to steal money from my table. That was their way of thinking. How much is this? Is this guy undercutting me? Mm-hmm. This guy coming in, working for pennies, and I'm going to lose my job that I'm actually relying on to feed my family. That was the old school of thought. And all of a sudden, a new person coming in, instead of like being somebody else coming in trying to steal our jobs, instead it was another mark wanting to learn how to wrestle. I run a training school, you know, come along, I'll show you a few extra things, £15 a session, £10 a session, whatever for the weekend. Do you want to hire the ring? All that kind of stuff. That became, it was an absolute 180. If you know the history of the business and how the politics of within the wrestling business operated and people's philosophies on new people coming in, it was an absolute 180. Did very little damage at the time. Let's face it, some of the first promotions in Scotland came from Hammerlock, one of the very first wrestling training schools. I came from training. I had a bit with the British guys, a bit with Jake. I went over to Canada. Did any of us at that time? Like, I think the people that started CW and SWA were generation before me. They were like 5 to 10 years, and then I came along. I see myself as like the generation after, even though we were probably set up at the same time. So I had even less business events that they did. And again, these are all mistakes that we've made. We were part of the problem, but there was very little wrestling at the time, so it seemed harmless. And I can speak for myself. I surrounded myself with a who's who of British wrestling at the time. The Knight family, Drew McDonald, Phil Powers. God, we had Tracy Smothers in the first couple of years. And the people that were that older than me, I made sure that Clark Conroy was involved. I did try and I always let Blondie Barrett, but I can't believe I mentioned late. Like I love Bob Barrett. He was one of the first people that gave me the time of day in wrestling, and I'll always appreciate that. Should have been first on my list. I'd always surround with those guys so I could learn and get better. And over the time, I'm really proud of what W3L is now. If I was, a lot of these promotions now are kind of doing what I did. Ran a show in 2003, we say that now, don't we? 2003. This is like 2023, but that was 2003. There's suddenly come a point where we abbreviate the year. But really, when I got up and running was when I came back from Canada in 2005, and that's, you know, so that's when WPL started. It didn't do as much damage because there wasn't anything else about. Now, the cycle continued. So from all these training schools, if you think about the first one, how many people that were trained in the Glasgow training schools have gone on to run their own training school?
Fair number. Yeah, quite a few, yeah.
Even one of the most recent ones, and they're all good training schools, so I want to really stress here, I'm not saying anybody's destroyed wrestling or anybody's the shits or anything like that. Quite the opposite, they're all, you know, brilliant. Maybe some of them aren't brilliant. For argument's sake, let's say they're all brilliant, absolutely fantastic, churning out the best wrestlers that they could possibly churn out. We're so many generations along now. Like, in every school that's set up, let's use the Glasgow area as an example because it's the most densely populated. Every school that's set up, maybe in the past 5 to 10 years, has tread on somebody's toes. Mm-hmm. I've even heard of a situation recently where a school that set up that was treading on one promoter's toes that was already there is now like as furious as one of their students for setting up their own school 5 years later when they did the same thing. It's like, that's what I mean by we all look at it through our own tunnel vision. That was great for them at the time because that's what benefited them. That's what's great for him now because that's what benefits him. He came from are like, how can you do this to us? You know, I've not heard their side of it. I'm just aware of the situation and there's friction there. It's that's the cycle we're in, and it's not going to stop. The person I'm thinking about in 10 years' time, I guarantee one of his guys will have set up next door to him. How many wrestlers is there? You've done those lists.
Right, my list, right, so this is all the promotions I cover, so it's 18 promotions plus CCW and all that. Last year, there was 345 wrestlers that had at least one match in Scotland between December 2021 and December 2022. So yeah, in 12 months, over 350 wrestlers. So, given that, with the extra promotions we don't cover, you're probably looking at 400 wrestlers that have come to Scotland in a year.
400 wrestlers in Scotland. I'm getting my calculator right here.
I'm saying that's ones that have had at least one match. So that could be guys that have been imported. But last year, I'd say about 400.
Well, let's say we take off the import, so we'll work with the figure of 300 because that's still substantial. How many wrestlers is there on a card?
Well, if you're going for a match card, you're probably looking at least minimum 16.
Okay, 16. That's if there's an 8-match card. Again, think to your budget. I wonder how much some of these guys are getting paid if they're able to afford an 8-match card. So 300 divided by, I mean, did we say 16?
Yeah.
Can you guess how many wrestling shows there would need to be in Scotland for every one of those wrestlers?
You have to test the maths here, but we're good.
I use the calculator. 18. There would need to be 18 wrestling events on any given day of the week for every one of those wrestlers to have a job.
Hmm.
I mean, why are we still training people? How many trainees do you think there is?
I probably look at a good 100 trainees at the very least as well. So, yeah.
Well, to make a training school viable, you need what, like at least 10 guys? You're probably more than 100 trainees. Where are they going to go? Where are they going to wrestle? There's the problem. So you have your team. And I've stood up in front of my team after COVID when we didn't have a training school. And I said, look, I could set up a training school again. They would help. Because I think given the financials and given the like, we've got some some absolute stars in terms of performance. Unfortunately, that's not reflected in their drawing ability. And it's a shame because, like, as an educated wrestling guy, you think that person's fantastic. From a business point of view, if that's not reflected in their drawing ability, if your face going on a poster doesn't immediately attract 30 extra tickets minimum that would not have been sold had you not been there, then you're worth the same as the next person. Maybe that's a controversial take, but...
No, I was thinking about this earlier. I was thinking about, we were talking about drawing and all that kind of stuff. Of course, I've been immersed in this Scottish wrestling stuff for 10 years. So if I see someone on the poster, I'm excited to see. That's just going to happen anyway. But when I was
You will, Billy.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm trying to think who is a draw. Who's a guy that you're like, outside of maybe their own hometown or home area, and there's only one name I could think of, and it was Grado.
100%, I agree.
Maybe Jack Jester would be another example because he does things like the Scots, he does stuff on BBC. So they would probably be my two, off the top of my head, would be your only active draws in Scotland everywhere.
So based on that, I think we should operate like the circus. Everybody pitches in with a big team, let's grow together. Mm. Now, if you have a training school, you have this luxury of the trainees do that work. That's like part of paying their dues. And 100%, like, I've been guilty it's not a terrible thing. Like, it makes sense. But what I've said to my guys is I could open a training school and we'd have however many guys here to help. And you wouldn't all need to be at the venue 2 hours before. But in a year's time, 2 years' time at the most, a handful of them will be ready, which means a handful of you guys will be gone. Mm-hmm. That's the reality. Because they maybe still want a place to train. But they'd only stick around if they were getting something from it because somebody will come up with so many shows. So you to keep their training money, you put them on. And they're maybe a bit cheaper because there's a bit of loyalty there. So you're not, like, I believe in... I think guys starting out think I'm a really good player. Guys more experienced, not so much, because I'm like, well, what financial worth are you going to have to me? And we'll work something out. It's just a vicious cycle. So if you don't put them on a show, what are they going to do once they've had a few matches? Maybe they'll start their own show. Who are we to stop them? We took their money every week for however many years and we let them in. We gave them the contacts. We gave them the skills or lack thereof. And now we're going to say, well, we're not going to use you, but we don't want you wrestling for this person because I don't like them. And we don't want you running your own show because that would step on our toes. And they're going to set up their own training school because, you know, why does a show, why does a promotion, why does a wrestling promotion need a training school when we have 300 wrestlers?
Yeah, I get
your, no answer to that, is there?
There's no, yeah, exactly. So I'm getting your line of thought there, but yeah, so it's a case of it's almost like, it's like the Wild West, isn't it? That's what wrestling is. It still is. It probably forever will be.
If you're just listening to this, though, and you run a training school, I'm not having a go at you. I'm not saying you should shut your business down. You're making money for that. Of course you're going to keep it running. All I'm doing is identifying the problem. I don't have a solution. I can see clearly from 20 odd years of being immersed in everything to do with this, I can see clearly how we've got to the point we're at.
Yeah,
have no solution. The only solution would be regulation, and I would money on that never happening because we're never going to agree on who regulates it.
Exactly.
If we self-regulate, somebody has to be in charge. If we government regulate, we're all out of business because the costs of regulation are astronomical.
I know. I was trying to think, like, I never want to be involved. This is as much as I want to be involved in wrestling. If I was offered to do things like backstage interviews, I'll happily do it, but I don't want to actually be involved in the wrestling business in any way, shape, or form. It's too much of a pressure. But I was thinking, what if I was running a regulatory body? And I'm thinking, yeah, that's a good idea and all, but like you're saying, like, who'd you let in? Then what's your qualifications from that point? I don't have any qualifications, but I'm just picking and choosing here who I would let in. And then there's companies I don't particularly enjoy their shenanigans or antics. Am I just going to boot them out for that reason? But then I become biased at that point because I'm taking over my own personal opinion. It's just a mess. There's no way to do it.
You can't do it. Nobody within the business can regulate the business. However, what I do think, and I guess this is why I wanted to put this out there, is no answer to these problems. But I guess by sharing it, I don't think anybody's spoken out the way, oh, I don't like that phrase. I don't think anybody has addressed this in the way I have, and so sort of specifically analytical of the timeline and the cause and effect of everything that we've done. I don't know if that's because they've not thought about it. Maybe they make their money from doing some of these things. They wouldn't want to think about it. I'm not suggesting that anybody stops or changes it. Perhaps just by floating this out there, it will make people think and just be aware of some of it, some of the damage that we're doing. I personally don't think it can be undone ever. I don't think it can be fixed. I'm just putting out why I think we're in this situation and why a lot of us, myself included, really have very little right to complain about it. Mm-hmm. We did it. We were all part of the problem. We took a closed business, we kept doors open, we said, come in everybody, we'll show you how we do what we do. For a tenner a week, that was the price we put on protecting our business. Mm-hmm. Tenner per person per week. And now it is what it is.
It's like a case that sports entertainment, that's the catch-all. That's what wrestling is, as we've said. It's now less about the sports and more about the entertainment, which, as a fan, love it. I'm happy with that. I like being entertained. But as a business, probably, like you're saying, it just means that everyone knows how it works. Whether they know how it works, but they know how it works at the same time.
There's a market for the not watching wrestling, market for understanding and exposing what happens behind the scenes of wrestling. And that would have been fine as a little bit extra. There's so many people that have come to rely on that. Like, how many people read the Wrestling Observer in the 80s and 90s versus how many people are aware of every single little backstage thing now? My stepson, who still, I work my kids, because they still believe and they still enjoy it. I'm not in a rush to tell them about Santa Claus and I'm not in a rush to tell them about wrestling. Just let them enjoy it. No. Know when it's the right time to know. I shudder when he puts YouTube on because they speak it like he started talking about heels and baby faces. He doesn't know what they mean. He's not put two and two together. He told us last year about Santa. He's figured that one out. He still believes in wrestling, so wrestling's outlived Santa Claus.
That's your Christmas T-shirt for W3L in December. I believe in wrestling.
It could be. We'll sell the Christmas jumper this year. The new website's just launched, so we've got all the T-shirts and stuff back on it. The nice red and green W3L showdown Christmas logo. I run a kids' club. Again, I'm just floating ideas out. Somebody might make something from this, or just be aware of the way of thinking, because it doesn't hurt to try and protect the business a little bit more. It's not going to suddenly put the toothpaste back in the tube. You don't need to expose the business like just freely all the time. Like, part of the magic is, like, you don't want to watch a movie and halfway through hear the director commentating on what's, you know, you watch that separately. You've got your behind the scenes of wrestling stuff, you've got your wrestling stuff. Don't mix them. Like you don't want that. I run a kids' club, the kids have a great time. A small group of kids, I kayfabe them. I don't have them fighting each other. I don't have them doing anything dangerous. I tell them this is how we do a wrist lock. I don't want you guys putting on any pressure because we're not here to hurt each other. You're just here to learn the technique. Mm-hmm. I will show them, because the beautiful thing about wrestling is it should be based in reality. Every wrestling hold, with the exception of one or two, you could explain how it would work in real life. That's what I do with the kids. They have a great time. They're told, you know, to never apply these holds on anybody like they would be told at judo or karate or, you know, any other martial art thing. I think this, I'm really proud of it, to be honest. When I hear about 10-year-olds having a fantastic wrestling match where they've learned all their spots, honestly, Billy, it actually breaks my heart. I have a child the age that still believes and enjoys wrestling so much more because he believes. He'll be smartened up when he's ready to be smartened up. Why teach those kids how to put on a wrestling match? Not some people that I have a huge amount of respect for do that. Not having a go, you're making money out of it as well. So that's brilliant. We've all got to bear bells. If we've got units before and costs, we've all got to do that. Just personally, it part me dies a little bit inside when I hear about it. What harm am I doing showing those kids how to do a wrist lock, explaining how it would actually hurt their opponent? I'm doing no harm. They're actually watching wrestling now, understanding the holds, understanding how they're applied, not thinking, well, it's all bent, so what was the point of me watching this all the time I grew up? You know, when somebody, and you said at the start, we're a niche product. I think if you ask the top 10 most popular things in a school, primary school, wrestling's going to be quite far down the list. It might make the top 10. It's not 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5. Mm-hmm. So when somebody says to them at school, oh, wrestling's all fake, because they're, why do people say that? Like, why do somebody's parents say, oh, you know all that's fake, don't you? Why? You don't say that when they're watching anything else. Mm-hmm. Like, these kids now know, well, no, that holds real. Here, give me an arm. And then the parents get a call. No, I tell them not to do that. But they, you know, our business can be respected and should be respected. Because we risk, I've got a herniated disc in my lower back. I walk about like an OAP and I'm 37. We put ourselves through so much, yet we're so willing to prostitute the secrets of our business and to so blasé about it and you know, work.
I mean, I did a podcast. I did a podcast recently for the Northeast Corner. So it's up in Elgin, actually. I was lost in my mouth and recorded it. And my first thing was, because they were like, oh, I used to watch wrestling growing up, getting back into it a little bit now. Like, my first thing was, if anyone listens to this, I know what wrestling is. So don't, like, not in a case of, like, I know how it works. Like, I know what wrestling is. I know what you're going to say in return to it. I know you're going to say it's not real. Let me enjoy 3 hours of my life and just let me believe for that time. Because, God, life is shit. Most of the time, the wrestling is your little pocket of believability where you could just, or a film, a Marvel film or something like that. It's your time to watch some superheroes do some cool stuff, and just let people enjoy it. You know, it's kind of.
I think it was with the brain Heenan that said, "For those who understand, no explanation is necessary. For those that don't understand, no explanation will do." And
there you
go. It much hits the nail on the head. Some people just can't pass this obsession of it's not real. Jesus, it's far more real than you think first, but like, who cares? What's your point?
Exactly. It's just people like to piss on your fire. I suppose that's the kind of thing. It's just everyone. Nobody can have a separate opinion, which is where we're kind of all are at with this whole topic, really. It's like everyone's got an opinion. Opinions are like arseholes. Everyone's got one.
Exactly. And this is something that not everybody will agree with, but like, I'm going to say it anyway. We don't help that if people think that about wrestling to begin with. And that's why I'm not, like, I'm fine with comedy as long as we can explain that it's real. Like, there's a brick in that get that the Bulgarian pickup carries to the ring. I can explain that. I can't explain, like, you know, a fake gun or something like that, or, you know, nonsense. I like to make sure that there's always, even if it's just a small crumb of explanation, I don't have that small crumb where I can explain, then I can't have it. Like, if we're so like, look, here's these 10-year-old kids having a wrestling match, isn't that amazing? Jesus, that wrestling shit's easy. Look at these 10-year-olds doing it.
Yeah.
I'm going to swear once, but on that, like, for fuck's sake, you know, look how easy wrestling is.
Yeah.
Makes me sad.
But my just thought is, why is there's not enough guns in wrestling? That would sort everything. That would just come out and go, right, no disqualification, gun. There you go.
Start with half the dressing room. No, we're not. I shouldn't say. if there's a terrorist attack on a wrestling show now, I don't want to be questioned over it. So that was a joke. I'm just going to highlight. Yeah,
But no, I can't believe we got a mention of the Bulgarian Baker in this. I'm so happy.
Slip in there.
I love him. I don't know if you listened to the episode of Big Demo, but I was talking about characters. He brought him up, and I was like, this is the best day of my life.
Oh, really? I've not spoken to Damon since he left. I need to reach out.
Yeah.
I almost said hello if you speak.
I'm so glad. I've missed him. I've missed the Bulgarian Baker so much. But yeah, we're speaking about that.
Not so much Damon, but you've missed the Bulgarian Baker.
I've missed Damon, but the Bulgarian Baker is just it's a fascinating character for me. But no, we were speaking about his time in WTL and stuff like that, and he just mentioned the Bulgarian Baker. And I was like, I don't know how I've got someone who's appeared in WrestleMania to speak about the Bulgarian Baker on my podcast, but that's my daymate. But yeah, Damon being back in the UK, that's pretty cool. Also, but this is totally off the topic. You've brought up the Baker, and it's discombobulated me, and I'm just now all fluster because of it.
Well, there we go. Do you know, if he ever comes back, see, this is the thing. If we bring the Bulgarian Baker back, he now needs an entrance video because of all our new tech set up. What would his entrance video be like? With lots of baguettes?
I was going to say, you can't really use pre-match, like, previous footage of him because he does change his appearance quite regularly, so...
Well, he has an eating disorder. Let's not be offensive here, you know? That's why he fluctuates with his weight so much. Be careful what you say. You'll hurt people's feelings. This is 2023. You can't comment on people's size like that.
Okay, the way I can... You can
you'll get cancelled.
Oh, if I was going to be cancelled, I would have been done by now. Okay, you can give me the weight one. That's fine. You've explained it to me. You can't explain the height. Anyway.
Stretches.
Anyway, this is not a Bulgarian Baker podcast. This is one day.
You should get him on one day. I'll try and hook you up.
Oh, that's episode 200 in the ticking over there. So yeah, I think we've covered that pretty well. I don't know if you've got any closing thoughts, but
well, I have. I feel better now. Again, like, don't, please, nobody take offence to whatever I've said. I'm just saying, look, everyone's complaining about this. I'm guilty of being part of why we're here. So we're all you. And here's why. And here's how it was. Somebody 20-odd years ago explained to me how great this new concept of training people to wrestle was. And over time, it snowballed.
Wrestling now, is the ultimate multi-level marketing scheme.
Yeah, but yeah. Like, the thing about, you know, like, how quickly rabbits multiply, you know?
Yeah. So, yeah, that's... So, yeah, if anyone's listened to this podcast, pretty much we've given you everything that's went wrong, but we've given you no solutions with it either.
No, there is no solution.
So.
Fuck.
Anyway, let's speak about something else then, while I've still got a little bit of time with you. Last year, of course, I'm bringing this down a little bit more, though. Of course, we lost John Short. Of course, he was part of W3L. He did quite a lot of the ring announcing and was often found milling about at W3L shows. Just to maybe close us with a light-hearted tale, is there any John Short stories that you can share that possibly can be shared on a podcast medium?
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's nothing that, do you know, I actually did a podcast yesterday with Carl, Carl Conroy, sharing memories of John. I first saw John as a fan going to the WF show in Dunfermline, and you know, years later came quite close to John, and he was just such a character. I don't know how many John short stories you've heard. A lot of them aren't suitable for sharing. He was wonderfully eccentric, and I had him in my phone as Sir John Short. And it was just little things. Like every time I saw him, I would say, John Short, as I live and breathe, and give him a big hug. And he was, oh, nice to see you, Mike. Everybody's got a John Short impression as well. This one time, he phoned me up and I said, hi, John, how are you? And he went, oh, I'm terrible. And then he started, I looked at the clock. It was like 8 minutes in. I'd not said another word. He was saying to me, he started explaining, he's like, well, I'm hoping you've not been trying to contact me because there's something wrong with my phone line. I keep getting calls thinking I'm a wood preservation society and I can't understand why I'm getting these calls. So I phoned the phone company and it was someone from Pakistan that answered. So I hung up, and I tried again. So he goes on, like he had this thing where he didn't want to speak to any abroad call centres. So he basically told me that he'd made like 37 attempts to get through to somebody about this problem with his phone line, and that they were looking into it, they were working on it. He finished by saying, anyway, the reason for my call is I'm afraid for the time being, if you need to speak to me, need to send me a postcard. He wasn't joking. He was being deadly serious. He was concerned there was some that I might need to urgently speak to him. He wanted me to know that if there was an urgent matter that I'd needed to get in touch with him over because of the landline issue, I would need to send him a postcard. This is like 2017 or something like that. Who's sending postcards? Maybe send him a telegram. So anyway, I had a good laugh about the situation and enjoyed John being so frustrated at getting his Wood Preservation Society calls. Got an update on Christmas Eve. I missed the call, unfortunately. I got this big message, and again, it was about 5 minutes of explanation, and ended it by saying, so if you do need to get in touch, I'm happy to confirm landline's now working again. Well, I didn't want you worrying about it over Christmas, so I thought I'd let you know. Like I was going to be sitting there over the holiday period going, oh, for fuck's sake, John's phone's still not working. What are we going to do? This is ruining the festive season, knowing that John's phone isn't connecting properly. Yeah, he just wanted to phone and let me know so I wasn't worrying about his phone line over the festive period. And again, deadly serious, he would not see anything funny about that story. He would think it was normal. Like, obviously doesn't have a mobile phone, or didn't have a mobile phone. We have already spent probably hundreds of hours speaking about John in cars. I'm sure we'll spend hundreds of hours of more in the future speaking about John. He'll never be replaced. He'll never be replicated. And this Christmas was a bit difficult, to be honest. Every Christmas John would disappear before shows. You said you saw him milling about. Were he outside the venue at times, or you might spot him around Elgin, like on the day of a show day? I can tell you what he was doing. He was looking for Orkney Fudge. Loved Orkney Fudge. Yeah. He didn't know how to order it online. So I would phone him to book him for dates. He's, oh, thank you for calling, Mike. We've run out of Orkney Fudge, so I'd be delighted to come back to Scotland. that's how he is Orkney Fudge. He'd go, he'd get to the venue super early so he could wander about town looking for Orkney Fudge. When I find out about this, I started a tradition of buying him a piece of Orkney Fudge delivered to him every year. And when somebody passes, you kind of forget sometimes. And I kept thinking, like, going through my Christmas to-do list in my head, like, John's Fudge, and then I go, oh, he's not around anymore. So John was, a wonderfully eccentric man, not a bad one in his body, loved wrestling, and like everybody in wrestling loved John. If they didn't, something wrong with him, because he will never be replaced. What a fantastic man. You heard he's in our intro now?
Oh, sorry?
He's in our intro now. He's omnipresent. So the sort of the logo intro thing, signature intro that plays before any W3L show. I think he's saying we want you to enjoy yourselves. I was looking for a once again put in, but like for all the times he said once again, I didn't have it in clear enough audio. I thought that clip that we found in the intro was quite nice. It was a creature of habit when he said the same thing every time. And he would when he was opening a show and he would go through the routine, if you see someone you like, hear them, chant their name, encourage them. And the whole routine, I would be backstage like mimicking him, like singing. You know how they used to just sing along with The Rock, like to all his catchphrases?
Yeah.
I'd be doing that with John Short during the introduction. When he first would start, he'd be like, good evening, Elgin. Oh dear, referee, should we hold hands and contact the living? That was his stock response to a lukewarm reaction to good evening.
Love it. Every time I have listened to some of Carl Conroy's podcasts, and it's really fast. They're big, meaty episodes, though. So you got to have a little bit of time, but they are. Every story I hear about John Short is literally that he's an eccentric, sweet man. No, not a bad bone, not an intended bad bone in his body. Some of the stuff, yeah, could be close to the bone, near the knuckle, but it's never his intention to be that way.
I was just to close off, because I know you've got time constraints, but just speaking to John, I keep forgetting to upload this, and I will. Let's get this 2 seconds. Carl at the moment is going through like John's house, and John would always have his camera with him. And if you can see that, that's John there on the, is that the right of the screen when it gets flipped? And you can see Blondie Barrett at the other end. That's Jimmy Meadows, myself, and little Michael, my son. So I remember taking that and was delighted when Carl found it and sent it on. So I'll probably share that. But yeah, what a great man.
That seems like a nice little sweet way to finish off this episode. So for plugging, if you want to plug what's coming up for W3L, for yourself at all, or direct to new website or whatever you want to
do. New website. Have you seen the new website, Billy?
I think I looked at it briefly on my phone. Hang on, I'm just going to bring it up now to have a look. What's the website address?
It's w3lwrestling.com. It was, we had a website which was good. It crashed about a year and a half ago. And Cage Tyler, who you're familiar with, he used to run Pride Wrestling. He looked after our graphics. He did an amazing job for years on our graphics. He took a step back from wrestling, but he was still hosting our website. He's been an amazing help. I can't sing his praises enough. When it crashed, he didn't really have time. He wasn't in wrestling anymore. He didn't have time to redesign the website. He got us a shell of a website up, really just duplicates. That's all it did. It was basic. It did what it said on the tin, so it kind of sat on the to-do list for a while to relaunch. We've now, just this past weekend, we don't know when this will air, recently, we relaunched the website. It's now basically our shop window for all things W3L. There's information on our video content through our YouTube channel and through our office on demand service. And this is our t-shirt store is open back up. which for £15, you could, this is my personal favourite, you can buy one of them over at wflwrestling.com. And of course, all our events that we've got coming up, we've got Carnage in the Capital in Edinburgh, April 13th. We've got Ponset down in England on the 14th. On the 15th, we've got a joint show with our friends at Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, and that's in Lark Hall. And then later in the month, we've got we're back at in Dunblane. We've got Doug Williams in Dunblane, the Dunblane Centre. That's April 29th. April 30th, we're back at Carnegie Leisure Centre in Dunfermline, again featuring Doug Williams. And then we have May Day in Gala Shields, again featuring Doug Williams. We've got lots of fun stuff coming up. And if you stay tuned, Billy, you will have some good news about Elgin in July.
Excellent. Let's hopefully... I'll be keeping an eye on the date. Actually, I know what date it won't be, because that'll be my son's birthday party. So I know you won't be booking that day. So otherwise, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today, Mike. I'm glad that we got this kind of arranged and set up, and looking forward to see what discourse and what discussion comes from it. Hopefully all good.
I feel a lot lighter now, Billy. I've lost about like 2 stone of baggage that I had on chest with sharing all of this, but I hope you find it interesting and your listeners find it an interesting take, and I've tried to keep it factual as well. It's not like some parts of my opinion, but a lot of it is like, this is factually what's happened. It's not something that we disagreed with. There might be opinions surrounding it. I've just laid out what brought us to this point,
and neither of us have had a almost had an aneurysm over it, so it's all good. But no, thank you again.